Good morning. Pleasure to be with you. Prior to 1993, chronic diseases killed people. Chronic diseases stopped killing people in 1993, in case you didn't get that memo. And that transformation was courtesy of an epiphany by Bill Fagey and Mike McGuinness, who published a seminal paper in JAMA in that year entitled Actual Causes of Death in the United States. And what McGuinness and Fagey pointed out should perhaps have been obvious all along, namely, diseases aren't really causes. Diseases are effects. And they asked and answered the question, effects of what? So while it was still true that people were dying prematurely of heart disease, cancer, stroke, diabetes, etc., those weren't really the causes that were taking years from life and life from years. The root causes were the things that caused the chronic diseases. And that proved to be a list of 10 factors elucidated in McGuinness and Fagey's paper. And what's interesting about that list is that overwhelmingly it's stuff we can control in our daily lives. And the full list need not concern us here this morning in the span of 18 minutes, because 80% of the action was just the first three entries on that list. 80% of the premature deaths that occur in the United States each year were attributable in 1990 to tobacco, poor diet, and lack of physical activity. Now, that's an old vintage. I trust you like your data fresher. This analysis was revisited after a decade by Ali Mokhdad and others at the CDC, and all that had really changed in the span of 10 years is that the gap between tobacco as the number one cause of premature death and the combination of what I like to call bad use of feet and forks as number two had narrowed. For one good reason, less smoking, and one bad reason, worse eating, less physical activity, worsening epidemics of obesity and diabetes to show for it. Now, the people of Potsdam have something to add to our understanding of not just the causes of premature death, but the remedy. Earl Ford and colleagues conducted survey research among 23,000 adults in and around Potsdam, Germany. They asked them about four factors in their lives. They asked them, do you smoke, yes or no? Do you eat well, yes or no? Habitual intake of fruits, vegetables, and whole grains. Are you physically active on a regular basis, yes or no? And is your weight well controlled, yes or no? Now, let's digress just for a second to note that weight, unlike the other things on the list, is not a behavior. Weight is an outcome. Weight is not a choice. Did anybody wake up and decide what to weigh today? It may be that wrestlers do that, but nobody else does, right? So we tend, I think, to make a mistake about that when we think about incentivizing weight outcomes, because people don't directly control weight. They control it indirectly, and to the extent they control it indirectly, it's because of two factors already on Ford's list: calories in and calories out, diet and physical activity. End of digression, back to our regularly scheduled program. So Ford and colleagues asked these 23,000 people about these four factors, and what they then went on to do was compare the two ends of the spectrum. So they compared, I don't smoke, I eat well, I'm physically active, my weight is just where it ought to be, to I smoke, eat badly, don't exercise, my weight is out of control. These people, over the span of their lifetimes, had an 80% lesser rate of all major chronic disease than these people. Flip the switch from bad to good on any one of these factors, and the lifetime probability of any major chronic disease goes down about 50%, but fire on all four cylinders, and the lifetime probability of all major chronic disease aggregated, heart disease, cancer, stroke, diabetes, dementia, etc., is slashed an astonishing 80%. Now imagine if the news were to break tomorrow, front page above the crease of whatever you like best to read, or these days I guess it would be a computer screen, that there's a new drug available, by prescription presumably, FDA approved, in bountiful supply, stunningly inexpensive, shockingly free of side effects, safe enough for children and octogenarians alike, and taken once daily for the rest of our lives would reduce the risk of all major chronic disease by 80%. What would everybody do first? Call their doc to get a prescription or call their broker to buy stock in the company that owns the patent on this stuff? I don't know, but both would be excellent ideas, but for the fact that there is no such pill, and in my opinion, there never will be any such pill. But lifestyle is exactly that medicine, and we've known about it since 1993 at least. Anyway, if you happen not to like Potsdam for some reason, or prefer your data fresher still, these findings were reaffirmed by a cohort study in the UK by Kavavik et al. A couple years ago, more recently than that, yet again here in the US by McCullough et al. In essence, what we have is a repetitive drumbeat in the peer-reviewed literature spanning decades, telling us over and over again of the incredible power over nothing less than our medical destinies of this very short list of lifestyle factors. Nor is the beat of this drum consigned to its surface. Rather, it reverberates to our very pith and marrow, to within the double helix of DNA. Here we are, more than a decade into the genomic age. We have not found the off switches for chronic diseases in the genome. But maybe we can stop looking there, because the nature-nurture debate serves up a false choice. We're now in the epigenetic age. Most of us know this. We can, in fact, nurture nature. In the study on the slide by my friend Dean Ornish and colleagues, they enrolled 30 men with early-stage prostate cancer amenable to watchful waiting. But rather than just watch and wait, they gave these men lifestyle as medicine. Optimal plant-based diet, obviously no tobacco, good physical activity. And in addition to that, they mitigated stress, they all got enough sleep, and they had strong social interactions. And by the way, that's my six-cylinder engine. Feet, forks, fingers, sleep, stress, and love. Get those right, after that, everything is vanishingly less important. They got those right, and over a span of months, studied not so much the men, and not so much the cancer in the men, but the genes in the men with the cancer. And they found that the lifestyle intervention took 500 cancer promoter genes and dramatically downregulated their expression, 50 cancer suppressor genes and dramatically upregulated their expression. The power of lifestyle as medicine is such that it can transform our fate at the very level of our genes. In the epigenetic age, DNA is not destiny. To a substantial degree, often neglected, dinner may be destiny. And this is not just one study, it's a branch of the literature that's filling out fast. So I think the case can be made, and indeed dare hope the case has been made in these few minutes, that the master levers of medical destiny are not the tools of the medical trade. Nothing we're taught to carry through the corridors of hospitals, not PET or SPECT or fMRI or robotic surgery. The master levers of medical destiny are what we do every day with our feet, our forks, and our fingers. And I trust you know what Archimedes said about a lever. Give me one long enough and I can move the whole world. Well, that's transformational. Make no mistake, these levers are long enough and could long since have served to move the whole world of modern epidemiology and public health to a better place. But, alas, we like to say knowledge is power. Would that it were so. The gap between what we know and what we do with what we know belies that wishful thinking. So as we convene here this morning, if we are seeking transformation, we must engage in translation. The arduous miles of translating what we have long known into what we routinely do, because we have been stuck, and the status quo is reaping a whirlwind, epidemic obesity, diabetes, chronic diseases at ever younger ages. I'm sure you know the epidemiology. There's something fairly monumental in our way. In essence, if you take this and you add this, inevitably you get this. Much as if you took this and added this, you would get this. And I give you my figurative trademark for the better part of 20 years, the polar bear in the Sahara. Now, when my wife and I first made this slide, there was no imminent threat of this actually happening to polar bears. That appears to have changed over the past 20 years. Maybe Al Gore will come to the next conference and address that for you. My point is, we are polar bears in the Sahara. We live in a world that has transformed around us, but not necessarily in a good way. Throughout most of human history, calories were relatively scarce and hard to get, and physical activity was unavoidable. It did not require gym membership or specialized footwear. It was called survival, and everybody did it every day. We've devised a modern world in which physical activity is scarce and hard to get, and calories are unavoidable. Houston, we have a problem, and Rochester, and every place in between. I submit to you that as a species, we have no native defenses against caloric excess or the lore of the couch, never having needed them before. We are polar bears in the Sahara, except, arguably, we are smarter than the average bear. So maybe we have one native defense after all. Great big Homo sapien brains. We got ourselves into this mess, maybe we can get ourselves out. And the challenge, I don't think, ought to be knowing where there is. Good use of feet, forks, and fingers, adequate sleep, mitigating stress, loving relationships. That's lifestyle as medicine. The challenge is getting there from here. And to do that, and that's what my career is all about, permit me to switch my metaphors. I began with the master levers of medical destiny. I want to talk about a levee. I like the levee metaphor because the problem may be likened to a flood of highly processed, hyperpalatable, nutrient-dilute, energy-dense, glow-in-the-dark, bet-you-can't-eat-just-one kind of foods, a constant flow of marketing dollars encouraging us and our children to eat the very foods that propel us toward obesity and chronic disease, wave after wave of technological advances giving us gadgets that do all the things muscles used to do at work and play. You want to contain that flood, you need something like a levee. It fits. I also like it because it incrementalizes both the problem and the solution, just stacked sandbags. No one of us has to fix it. And I also like it because it's a precautionary tale. We're a quick fix, active ingredient, silver bullet kind of society. No one thing we do will transform this problem. The epidemiology of obesity and chronic disease, that would be like putting down one sandbag and asking, are we dry yet? The fact that we're not does not prove it's a bad or defective sandbag. It just means there's more work to be done. The solution looks like this, and because of that, I am a sandbagger. I aspire to nothing else. That's what I do. Manufacture, test, stack, and as appropriate, attempt to disseminate sandbags. For instance, No Child Left Behind has been leaving our children on their behinds for the past 20 years, right? We've been jettisoning phys ed and recess from school. No time for that nonsense. So we built a sandbag, ABC for fitness, activity burst in the classroom, a free program, comprehensive brief activity burst any teacher can dole out. We studied this in 1,000 kids. We saw significant improvement in key measures of fitness, stable performance on all standardized tests, decreased behavioral problems, significant reduction in all medication use, and by the way, a 33% reduction in medication use for ADHD, because the proper remedy for rambunctiousness in children is recess, damn it, not Ritalin. This is a free program. It's in thousands of schools. This, thank you. Part of a bigger story, sound mind, sound body should sound familiar. It's the kind of sense our grandparents had, and now we're finding our way back to it with randomized controlled trials. Right? It was right all along. Reading, writing, arithmetic, and the right kind of recess retooled to fit the modern school day are synergistic, not competitive. We built a comparable sandbag for adults, ABE for fitness, help yourselves, activity burst everywhere. This is a free library of online videos to guide us in our business attire. Through brief activity bursts, you can accumulate the 30 minutes a day. We built a sandbag on the nutrition side for kids, nutrition detectives. It's a food label literacy program, teaching young kids in 90 minutes out of an entire school year, and a free DVD available in English and Spanish, how to identify and why to choose more nutritious foods. We did a study in 1,200 families. Not only did this significantly enhance the food label literacy of the kids, it did the same for the parents. And we didn't talk to the parents. We just infected their children with knowledge and sent the little vectors home and let them do the rest. Right? This program is all around the world. It's freely available. Help yourselves. And we're trying to reach out with a sandbag for middle schoolers now. They're hard to reach, so we have a music video program called Unjunk Yourself, and we want to stir up a little bit of righteous indignation. My signature contribution to the levee is a nutrition guidance system. Built it for many reasons, partly inspired by my patients, but partly by my wife, who has a PhD in neuroscience from Princeton, and even so has a hard time figuring out which loaf of bread is the most nutritious. I asked the feds to do this in a meeting with the Secretary of Health back in 2003. They didn't. We did. International team of colleagues helped me build the overall nutritional quality index algorithm. All of these nutrient components are entered, weighted for their health effects, and it sees daylight as a system called NuVal. We consider it GPS for nutrition. It doesn't tell you where to go, just tells you how to get there if you're so inclined. 1 to 100, the higher the number, the more nutritious the food. We've studied it extensively. These are the citations on the slide deck. More importantly, it was studied in Harvard. 100,000 people, NuVal scores all their foods. The higher the average NuVal score of their diets, the lower the rate of cardiovascular disease, the lower the rate of diabetes, and the lower the rate of premature death from any cause whatsoever. And if you want to put a face on it, Sally Galvin, wife, mother of two, shops in a supermarket that has NuVal over 18 months. By trading up her groceries and not much else, she lost 115 pounds, and unlike a diet, she didn't leave her family behind. It's currently in about 2,000 supermarkets nationwide, reaching about 40 million shoppers. I sleep a little better at night for knowing that. But there's a lot left to do, so I have a dream. First, it's not true that more nutritious food always costs more. The bigger problem is most people can't identify the more nutritious food that doesn't cost more, but the dream is called fingertips, partly because I want to put empowering programming right at people's fingertips, and partly because it's a kick-ass acronym. Financial incentives, nutritional guidance, and educational and retail settings, taking it to the people in the street. That is a kick-ass acronym, if ever you heard one, right? The idea is this. Think about it. We send $100 billion a year to the feds to underwrite SNAP, food stamps, to help poor people choose poor food to get to poor health. We spend a ton more money through Medicaid to pay the cost of all that poor health. Who in this scenario is winning exactly? Everybody loses. What if we gave NUVAL scores, we scored over 100,000 foods, to all SNAP beneficiaries attached to financial incentive, so when you used a dollar to buy a food in the bottom quartile, it was worth a dollar. But in the next quartile of scores, it's worth $1.25, the next $1.50, the top $2. Financial rewards for better food to get to better health and save a ton of money. Doing it, everybody wins. And if in the public sector, why not transform the private sector? Have large employers and insurers put a system like this in supermarkets, add an incentive to the loyalty card program and say, hey, you get to grow your market share, the shoppers get paid to get healthy, and we reduce the cost of doing business, our profit margins widen, everybody wins. The bright future of health promotion is win, 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 and wind in our sails. We're here at the Mayo Clinic. We need to acknowledge humbly, and of course I'm a physician and I practice, that healthcare really doesn't make health. Health is built from its foundations in the places people live and love and learn and work and pray and play, the places people really spend their time. We can acknowledge, though, that clinicians are either part of the solution or part of the problem. We can be part of the solution. We offer a free CME program, by the way, 4 hours of Category 1 CME credit for free, called OUCH, Online Weight Management Counseling for Healthcare Professionals, based on 15 years of behavior modification research. This, too, is a sandbag in the levee. But fundamentally, as the president of the American College of Lifestyle Medicine, I can say, yes, we should practice lifestyle in medicine. But the bigger transformation is having lifestyle function as medicine. And then, frankly, everybody just needs a whole lot less medicine. But we have to get that medicine to go down. Lord knows the last thing we need these days is more spoons full of sugar. But I think we do need a spoon. And in this case, the big spoon is culture. In those places where lifestyle is the medicine and culture is the spoon, you wind up with a blue zone, the highest concentration of the longest lived, healthiest, happiest people on the planet. In our culture, for far too long, health has languished on the road not taken. I think we'd all like to see it on a path of lesser resistance. That's not just a clinical enterprise. It is a cultural enterprise. We can get out of the dark wood of modern epidemiology, but only if we see the big picture. Forest through the trees, or if you will, the elephant in the room. It was six men of Indistan, to learning much inclined, who went to see the elephant, though all of them were blind, that each by observation might satisfy his mind. The first approached the elephant and happening to fall against his broad and sturdy side, at once began to bawl, God bless me, but the elephant is very like a wall. The second, feeling of the tusk, cried, ho, what have we here? So very round and smooth and sharp, to me 'tis mighty clear, this wonder of an elephant is very like a spear. The third approached the animal and happening to take the squirming trunk within his hands, thus boldly up and spake, I see, quoth he, the elephant is very like a snake. The fourth reached out an eager hand and felt about the knee, what most this wondrous beast is like is mighty plain, quoth he, 'tis clear enough the elephant is very like a tree. The fifth who chanced to touch the ear said, e'en the blindest man can tell what this resembles most, deny the fact who can. This marvel of an elephant is very like a fan. The sixth no sooner had begun about the beast to grope than seizing on the swinging tail that fell within his scope, I see, quoth he, the elephant is very like a rope. And so these men of Indistan disputed loud and long, each in his own opinion, exceeding stiff and strong, though each was partly in the right and all were in the wrong. So oft in theologic wars the disputants, I ween, tread on in utter ignorance of what each other mean and prate about an elephant not one of them has seen. I fear we're prone to much the same tendency in epidemiology, but my friends, from the start it was my intention to make the case for good invention. For where there's a will, there's a way to be paved, so the health of our patients, our families, and our culture can be righted and saved. And I'm confident we can all escape our doom if we just see the elephant, or possibly the polar bear, here in the room. Thank you all very much.
Thank you. You are too good, Katz.
Thanks.
Whoa. Oh, my God.
Thank you.
No, that was awesome. Lots of questions here. You know, first of all, you know, you're talking about a lot of programs, and the sandbags, I think, is a great metaphor because in many ways, you know, you're trying to have an impact on behavior, and you're providing incentives and an alternative view. How difficult is it as a sort of broad public health you know, solution to make these work to scale?
So it's a great question. It depends. First of all, the reason that I like the sandbag approach is very often you can do one little thing where you can't do everything. So you think about schools. We've done a lot of our work in schools, not exclusively, but you know, it's a good place to intervene. And there are these wonderful comprehensive programs like Catch and Planet Health. But it reminds me of a scene in the Father of the Bride, from that movie, when right. the wedding planner comes to the house, they look around the house, and they say, oh, it's beautiful, we'll change it all, though. And you know, these programs basically say that to the schools. You know, your curriculum's great, but we have to tear it down and start from scratch. The schools that do that, I think, benefit enormously, but many are not willing to. So we can offer ABC for fitness by saying it's free, it takes no extra time, you're just going to basically do physical activity. During that time, you used to say, sit still, keep your hands to yourself, don't throw things, don't pull her hair, don't even think about it, pay attention, during the downtime. It requires no resources, no special training. You know, there's no reason not to do it. And that's 30 minutes of physical activity a day. Start there. Then you've got their attention, and they say, what else have you got? And you add another, and you add another. So the scale in any individual setting is somewhat organic. Then, if you have success in one setting, it's far more effective, I find, for teachers and principals and superintendents to peddle school-based health promotion programming than for me as a preventive medicine doc, because, of course, they say, well, hey, that's your day job. We've got a day job. We're teachers. But when they hear it from fellow teachers who say, actually, it's easier to teach the kids when we do this. Standardized test scores are going up because we're doing this. They sell it for you. So ABC for Fitness is in thousands of schools. That's scale. Nutrition Detectives is all around the world. We've heard about it in all 50 states, Canada, Mexico, Spain, the UK, New Zealand, Australia, South Africa, the Philippines, Russia, and India. There may be other places too, but you know, that's where we've heard about it. So sometimes I think you can get to scale organically, and then sometimes you have to start at scale. Nuval, the only way for that system to really be worthwhile in a supermarket is to score the whole damn food supply, right? We have 100,000 foods scored. Well, that was a huge undertaking. About $30 million has been spent. So to try and, you know, in public health, we say think globally, act locally. That often works. In some cases, the only solution is a global solution. So I think it depends. And I, you know, I think basically we want to be nimble. Look at the problem, think about the best solution, and devise one that matches the circumstances.
How do you score the food supply for something like the SNAP program without conveying a kind of paternalistic government decides you can't have your freedom if you have the SNAP coupons?
So two ways. First, I'm an equestrian, and so you know, both in health promotion and when I'm on horseback, I prefer carrots to stick. I can tell you my horse much prefers carrots to stick. So you know, I think if you're telling people what to do, taxes, you can't buy this, this is off limits, I think you have to have that debate. You are being paternalistic. Now, you could argue for paternalistic libertarianism. You could talk about nudge and the fact that maybe we do need better defaults in our culture. And those arguments have been made, and they're pretty compelling. But I think the argument goes away when you deal with carrots. So again, what I'm proposing is put food in categories, breads, cereals, dairy, pasta sauces, score them and say, your dollar will never be worth less than a dollar, your voucher for a dollar. But it could be worth more if you choose foods that overall are more nutritious. You don't have to, but you essentially accumulate savings to use in other ways if you do that. And what we will give you is guidance to those better scores. So you are now empowered. I don't think it's paternalistic to empower people. And in fact, you know, I routinely invoke the Spider-Man movies because everybody gets the notion that with great power comes great responsibility. I don't know that we extend that logic to its conclusion and recognize then that if we disempower people, they can't behave responsibly. And if we want to fix that, the first step is to empower them. And then, yes, I do think there is a role for personal responsibility. If we've made it easy to get to health by paving the way, and I think it's the job of the body politic to pave the way, I don't think it's the job of the body politic to carry each of us there, right? We have to get there under our own power. So, you know, I think this creates opportunity rather than imposes a paternalistic constraint.
Well, there's a synergy idea here in that, you know, you suggest that if you score foods and provide the incentives for people to get the best possible score by eating healthy, Janet Schwartz yesterday said that if you also encourage people to stick with that program so that they're not just, well, I'll do it for 1 month and then the next month I'll go back to, you know, sugary drinks. They'll stick with it if the financial incentive is withdrawn. So you actually can, people have a vested interest in staying with a program like that if you build that incentive in the back end.
Now, you're going in an interesting direction. I'm going to redirect slightly because I think you're raising a very provocative issue. And, you know, again, the transformation that I'm seeking is that lifestyle is the best medicine, culture is the spoon, right? Well, isn't it interesting that in our culture, you have to pay people to care about being healthy? My response to that is, what the hell, right? I mean, wait until you have money but your health is gone and see how you feel about that. And as a doc and my colleagues in the room, we've all dealt with that. You know, people who have the nest egg but neglected their health to get it. And how bluntly can I speak here? Is this a family program? Or can I say what they really say to me, which is along the lines of, oh shit, what have I done? Right? Because the thing they've lost is the thing they can't get back. So yes, I mean, we could keep incentivizing health, but I think we also need to raise daughters and sons who aspire to being healthy, who actually recognize that vitality is one of the most luminous currencies, and that you can spend that on hours of living well. And you can't spend anything else on hours of living well, because if you lose that vitality, no other currency will compensate. So yes,
there's a value to the long-term commitment. It's not simply a matter of individual.
And it's missing from our culture. Yep. I mean, we think it's rational that we have to pay people to care about health. I mean, imagine if you wanted to hire me and you offered me a lot of money and I said, that's it, how are you going to incentivize me to earn money? And you said, well, I can guarantee you'll get healthier doing this job. I said, okay, I'll sign up, right? You have to incentivize me to win the prize. The prize isn't the incentive. Health is a prize, and our culture, I think, needs to collectively wrap its mind around that notion. And then, yes, let's encourage it with money, too, but let's not neglect the fact that health is a luminous currency in its own right.
Questions. Great talk. So true. Why aren't we going after the high fructose corn syrup issue in all our foods to fight obesity? It is clear that is the issue, more important than tobacco at this point. How does the makeup for our food in the U.S. impact the food part of the equation? Too many preservatives. And let's see, one other. What is your view on regulating unhealthy foods and products with more tobacco products getting developed, vapor-based, constant unhealthy food development, GMOs and cronuts? Should government get involved to help turn the tide? What's your view on all that?
Okay, that's a lot.
Yeah.
Answer all of these, if you would. Well, okay, my view on government involvement, regulation, so forth, you know, I'm a public health guy. Shirley and I were talking before she came on stage, and agreeing, you know, she's doing wonderful work in Atlanta and now 10 cities, and good public policy is good public health. And very often the best way to get good public policy is from policymakers, right? And this involves regulation and legislation. I just think we ought to use the best, most effective, least onerous solution. It's a lot like medicine, right? I mean, if someone's got cancer, chemotherapy may be the right thing to do, but you wouldn't give chemotherapy to someone who's healthy just because they might get cancer, because, you know, essentially the toxicity of the treatment isn't warranted. Same thing here. Nobody likes being told what to do. But on the other hand, we've heard from Michael Moss, who's a Pulitzer Prize-winning medical journalist. His book is Salt, Sugar, Fat. Did a New York Times Magazine cover story, The Extraordinary Science of Addictive Junk Food. He wasn't the first to tell us this, by the way, but he told us recently and told us well that the big food companies have literal teams of PhDs whose job it is to design food we cannot stop eating. And when they told you, bet you can't eat just one, you may have thought it was, you know, cute and good marketing. It was a threat, and they came loaded for bear, prepared to back it up. So if that's what we're up against, yes, we ought to regulate, because it all it does is level the playing field. You know, essentially, we're being bullied as it is. But I think we can often avoid regulation, or we can use regulation to empower rather than, you know, tell people what to do. So again, I prefer financial incentives for better food as opposed to penalties. So again, looking for the sweet spot. Nobody likes being told what to do. None of us wants to be told what we can or can't have for breakfast. But I think the default should be good choices, and there's a role for regulation. There were a lot of other questions folded in there. High fructose corn syrup is the thing wrong. I would caution you. High fructose corn syrup is a very important thing wrong with the modern food supply. On the other hand, we have blown it every time we have missed the forest for the trees and decided there is just one thing wrong. It was just fat, it was just saturated fat, it was just trans fat. All we needed to fix our diet was, you know, add a sprinkle of oat bran to everything. Remember those days when there was a big banner ad on the front of everything contains oat bran? We could easily make the same mistake with high fructose corn syrup, and let me tell you two examples of how that can happen. One, my wife took our son out for breakfast, and they had pancakes, and we can leave aside whether or not he should have been having pancakes, but he did. But on the table was a bottle of alleged maple syrup with a big banner ad on the front across the picture of the maple woods. Now without high fructose in bigger letters, corn syrup, as if to say it's free of fructose corn syrup, how bad can it be? My wife took a look at the ingredient list. The first ingredient was corn syrup, just not high fructose corn syrup. The next ingredient was dextrose. There was a long list of other ingredients, including artificial colorings. Guess what was missing entirely? Maple. This maple syrup contained absolutely no maple. So we fall into that trap. And right now, Pepsi is trying to tell us that if they go from high fructose corn syrup back to sucrose, they're doing us a big favor and we can now drink soda all day long and not worry about it, and that's not true. So yes, it's a big problem, but it really is everything about our adulterated food supply. And it needs to be fixed. Regulation is part of the formula, but I would argue the single most effective way to fix and transform the food supply is to change the food demand. Because at the end of the day, whatever their motivations, what they want more than anything is to satisfy the shareholders and keep the customer satisfied. If we won't buy it, they can't sell it.
Dr. Katz, thanks so much.
Thank you, John. Pleasure. Thank you very much. Thank you.